Thanks.
Do you want me to do it? Mm-hmm. So,
I can handle it.
Are you sure?
I'm not sure, but I'll do my best.
Look at
there, I can handle that part.
Okay.
There you go.
So tonight's presentation, I mean, other than the fact that everybody keeps saying like we're in a declining market, it's over.
Seriously.
It is. Well, we can all go home right now. I got a movie to see later. We can go home. Let's see Alan Watts quote: "If orchestras were supposed to perform, if it was all about the end, it would just be one big crash at the opera. Just the you know the symbol." So tonight's presentation is on essentially a method for investing in any market across the country at any point in the market. Has anybody read or attempted to read Ray Dalio's Principles? Okay, so same idea. Using tonight's math and determine whether it's a viable place to invest. You know, we can get deeper into whether or not there's only one major employer in the area, all the small demographics, but essentially you should be able to put this model into a computer and the computer would just buy and sell for you and it would always be profitable. It's kind of the idea. Todd and I were arguing with Christina a lot about where the market was going. I think she said, "Well, it's about over," and we were like, "Oh, we've just could have just begun." But now we're under the same impression. I mean, we're done. I don't think there's any major cataclysmic event that anybody sees is going to happen. You know, if you really knew what was going on in 2007 behind the scenes, you really had an idea that market was turning, but no one publicly knew. None of us, at least no one I've talked to, has ever had a good theory on what the next market turn looks like and why. There's no event that's going to change things drastically. The biggest issue we have now is the internet, right? Like the speed of information. So the reason last market, at least my theory, the reason the last market turned so quickly is because speed of information. People knew very quickly what was and wasn't selling. You know, 1999 was when LA adopted the MLS, and our area was somewhere around 2002 in the Inland Empire. I mean, so the MLS as a whole, not being a book, you know, actually being on the computer is very new. Now all that information coming online has made it very easy to analyze markets. And the hedge funds knew that, and you'll see by a chart later in this presentation, the hedge funds were brilliant and we were stupid because they just went nuts. And everybody's like, why are they overpaying for everything? Well, if I had this information then, which I wish I did, we would have been doing the same thing. So it's over. Southern California real estate has moved from a buy and flip market to a speculative market. And I apologize if I trip over this presentation a little bit. It's the third time I've done it, and I tend to talk fast, and I've had a four-shot latte by 5 o'clock. And I'm going to do my best not to use the ridiculous amount of profanity or crass nature I get through every conversation with. Those of you who know me know that I don't pull punches. Let's see, is this thing working? Did we put the chip in? Aha. Okay. So, the title of tonight's presentation, how anyone can determine where we are in the real estate cycle using simple math. I say simple math with the exception of it requires you to use a financial calculator. So we're talking about financial calculators earlier. If you do not know how to use a financial calculator, you are 40 steps behind everybody else who does. You're going to lose that battle every time. If I could impress one thing upon you, learning to use a financial calculator changed my entire life as a real estate investor. Do that as soon as you can. Take a class on it. There are several. Bill Tan has one. Buddy Broom has a fantastic one from what I heard. I haven't taken his. And the Gary's is coming up. His is like both on both holidays, right? Labor Day and Memorial Day, I think. There's usually three or four a year you can go to. And ask anybody that's in the network. They'll tell you the good ones. And they cost you a couple $100. They're not expensive. I'm Stephen McKee. Like Christina said, this big logo up here on the side is our new company, Back Porch Homes. Todd and I are, to put our money where our mouth is, currently divesting from all our investments. We have 11 properties that are still in rehab, 14 total left. We had 25 or something like that a year ago that we went flipping. We're unloading every single piece of inventory we have and moving to tiny home manufacturing and carrying paper on tiny homes. We're currently in the middle of raising capital for that, our first $1.5 million. And we just bought our first trailer and got our first warehouse space to start building our prototype. Oh, this is a shorter presentation, so please interrupt. Yes?
So is that a universal, or are there markets where the cycle is different?
You mean is it over in... For sure, yeah. Yes. 100%. Matter of fact, there are markets throughout the entire country that, especially considering their own just city financials, you know, problems within the metropolitan area, whatever, they'll always make financial sense. I mean, there's probably, I'm not investing there, so I don't want to say this is for sure, but, you know, Tennessee for a long time, you know, maybe Ohio, you know, these places may go on for a very long time. They may be, you know, that market may be fluctuating, but they may always pencil as a rental. So you may always be able to buy there. And then that's the math we're going into, so you can determine for yourself in your market exactly where it is in the cycle. And really what it is it's you're saying, should I continue to buy with the current strategy I have, yes or no? And if no, what strategy am I changing to? That's all it is. There's a couple financial people throughout history that have used the same idea. I'm just trying to apply it to real estate instead of stocks. So value investing is an investment paradigm that involves buying assets that appear underpriced by some form of fundamental analysis. It's important to focus on the part of the fundamental analysis, right? Because, and I really do need glasses. I got an eye exam and I didn't get the glasses yet, and like I'm paying for it right now. We only buy when there's a discount on an asset, right? Everybody in real estate, if you don't know that yet, you're always buying a discount. You're looking for upside. You don't make your money when you sell, you buy. So you're always buying cheaper than what it's for. It doesn't mean you're ripping people off, just you're usually trading your knowledge for somebody's equity. So you can only calculate a discount if there is a logical value. Speculation is not logical, right? So if you buy a house at retail and put carpet and paint in it and replace the kitchen and hope to sell for more, you didn't buy at a discount, you were speculating, and if you get robbed, if you get burned, that's your fault. Right? You were hoping instead of investing. So there are three real estate market types. And this is, by the way, I made all this up. So if you guys are like, oh, I've never heard this before. Yeah, I just made this shit up and put it on the slides. Yes, I was going to get to that, Christina. Thanks. So, like I said, for those of you who don't know, I'm very crass and I don't wear a fancy suit. That's because usually Todd and I are hopping over fences and breaking windows. It's our job to get into houses and deal with regular homeowners. They don't like people in suits. Huh. There's a comma in there somewhere, a semicolon. We broke into a lot of houses that I probably shouldn't have been into to make money. But also, it really scares people when you're in a suit. I personally believe that a suit is for someone who's trying to sell something to you. Also, you tend to just blend in. So, there we have a buy and hold market, right? A market where you could buy rentals. You have a buy and flip market, a market where it makes the most sense to buy a property and resell it, fix it and resell it, or just resell it. And then the third market I call sell or pray. It's the speculative market. You either sell your inventory or you pray the shit doesn't go sideways. The math may get a little confusing if you don't know how to run a financial calculator. If you don't, trust me, I'm right. If you do, pull out your calculator. So when to buy and hold. So if you can buy a property with a fully amortized, right, fixed payment, a very normal, traditional, conventional loan, this is based on nothing down. Now, I know these loans don't exist, but the calculation is based on a zero down loan because when the markets get crazy, right, those weird loan products show up. So you have to figure they'll be a part of the market. With a fully amortized fixed payment below 75% of market rent. There are a lot of rules for buying a rental. There are expenses that come with every single rental property and kind of investment. You'll see people say that you need to buy at 50% of what your payment will be. You need your payment to be 50% of rent. Some people say 65, some people say 75. I'm using 75 because I'm assuming that when the market gets thin, this is for California, some markets may lean more towards that 50% mark, but if you're good and you have a good process, you can push all the way up to the 65-70 mark. You have vacancy and repairs, right? Those are usually in California considered 10% categories. 10% reduction in your annual rent for vacancy, 10% repairs. And we usually lump in taxes, insurance, in that an additional 5%. So 25% minimum overhead, maybe as much as 50% overhead, depending on the eviction process, whatever that may be. Bonus, right? This is, and if who's heard Bruce Norris speak on buying a home below replacement cost? Right? So bonus, if you can buy the property below replacement costs, at a disc or at a cash flow and below replacement cost, like it's the best market you could possibly be buying in, right? Assuming the fundamentals on the ground are there, right? The largest employer didn't just leave, you know, some Midwest town. So if you buy like this, everyone is a replacement buyer, right? There's a retail buyer, there's an investor buyer, everybody can buy your property. So when to buy and flip? Anybody heard the, I'm sure a lot of you have, the rule if you want to buy and flip, you buy at 75% of ARV minus repairs, or 70% of ARV minus repairs, or whatever that number is. Everybody's got a number, right? So Todd and mine has always been 75. That's a 15% cash on cash return. If you're buying at 70, you're pushing 20 plus, allows for big margin of error. A lot of people don't consider square footage. It's important when you're trying to determine what comp you're looking at, that you're looking at size. The size of a home in a market changes, right? Like, you may find in the Midwest that the median-sized home is 1,200 square feet. You may find in, like, I live in Rancho Cucamonga, right? My median-sized home is probably 2,200 square feet. It's based on the size home for that market. There are plenty of retail buyers, right? There's plenty of people. If you're buying at a discount, there's plenty of people to buy after you fix it up or not, you know, to resell it to. Probably not an investor, but an end user. So there's less buyers, but there's still plenty. So when to sell or pray, like right now? The current income can no longer afford to buy the current median-sized home. What I'm telling you isn't that tomorrow we're going to dive off a cliff, right? What I'm saying is, at some point, lending will dry up. Commercial paperwork kind of disappear. The market will slow down. Lenders won't put themselves out of a job. Their investors will, right? Like people, money will get tighter, and there will be fewer and fewer replacement buyers, and people will start lowering their prices to sell to those remaining replacement buyers. And that's when we lose money. I lost a significant amount of money in 2007 because I didn't know this. Yes. A replacement buyer is like if you're the initial buyer, so you bought the property, you need to replace yourself to get rid of the home, right? So it's the person buying the product from you. All right, we need a few pieces of data. Now, if you're not a data junkie, you may have not dug for this data before. Most of it is readily available online. It's all free, with the exception of the Marshall and Swift data. By the way, I'm gonna put these slides in the comment section of the meetup page as soon as I'm done so you can download them all. And I'm gonna give you a phone number to text me to get copies of the slides. That way you can take this math with you and pick your market and do the math. At some point, Todd and I are gonna turn this into a computer program that just does it automatically for you, but we haven't got our team moved to that project yet. One of our team members is building a new deck to help raise a new round of financing for the product find sellers that we invested in, so we can't get them turned on to this yet. Keeps asking though. Okay, right. Everybody done taking pictures? Okay, so the median annual household income just comes from the U.S. Census, right? We only do it every so often. You know, they make estimates as to the what the median income is over time. Your local municipality may have much better local data, right, based on surveys or whatever they've done. So look at your local municipality, talk to somebody at the city. They may have really accurate data on that. Home size sold, that's in the MLS. You probably get it from title. It'd be hard to get out of Redfin or Zillow or something because you need basically every sale in an entire, at minimum, quarter, if not a year. When I'm talking about this data, by the way, I'm talking about it in quarters. So all of this data has to be 3 months worth of data. Otherwise, there's kind of not a big enough pool of data to give you an accurate number. Yes?
Do you use Zillow a lot for that?
For this kind of data? Zillow has fantastic charts, and so does Trulia, especially for like schools and trends and whatever. But when I use, when I pull this data, there's not enough data in Zillow because they just give you like the their formula, their answer, and I can't rely on what their formula is on the back end to know if it's accurate for what I need. So those of you who have MLS access or have a realtor friend that has MLS access, you have them take, let's say it's for median home size, median sales price, and median rent. Those are three categories that have come from the MLS. You have them sort by whatever the criteria is, right? You sort by rent, by square footage, by price. Then you look at record 500 and the ones around it, and that's your median, that's the middle. We don't do averages because sometimes highs and lows can really throw them off. You find the median. Building cost per square foot. So building cost per square foot, to get a pretty decent number, it has to come from Marshall and Swift, appraisers and insurance will have Marshall and Swift data. They're your contact. You can also buy the report from CoreLogic directly. I think it's $89 a year or something. It's not expensive. And that's gonna tell you, you know, just for that area, for the type of home, size of home, quality of home that you're looking at, what's the cost to rebuild that? We need the national average interest rate. You can get it on FRED. If you know what FRED is, FRED is the St. Louis Federal Reserve. FRED has amazing charts. If you just type FRED, it'll be the first thing that comes up. And when I did this data, I did it based on a year. Quarter, and it'll tell you what the interest rate is that the people get across the nation on average for that quarter, year, whatever term you're looking. And I just do it nationwide. I don't pick a local area. I don't look at, like, is the interest rate in Pasadena compared to the interest rate in Oklahoma. If your data is that close, you should be questioning your market anyway. When we do the application at some point, it'll be that accurate, but for this presentation, I'm not going that far. So median, like I said, median sales price and median rent you get from the MLS. Okay, so we need to use this data to calculate a few payments and values. So we need to use a financial calculator to fill in some blanks and things we don't know. Now, you'll hear people talk about all kinds of different ways. Yes, Christina?
Can you describe the
permit
number that you're
using now? Oh, yes. If you would like to use the 10b2 app, where's my 10b2? It is the one by, what's the one in the app store? It's orange is brown. It's like turd brown, and it says 10bii on it, and I think it's $6. And the guys who created the app are in Southern California. They're in this club network. And it's a extremely good version of this calculator. I use it on a daily basis. They also have videos built into it on how to use it. So, yes, in a day. So if you search 10BII, it should be the very first result, I think. Yes, yes. I'd pay $599 for the stupid thing. Like, it's the handheld calculator. It's $30. It's good, but this thing gives you so much more.
And it's more user-friendly because it shows what's in your cell, so you don't have to figure out where you are. If you
like me, I'll give you an example. It took me about a quarter of the time to calculate all this data using that calculator versus a traditional one. And it gives you the full amortization table, which very few do. Okay, so first, baseline, right? If you're doing a scientific study in any way or you're trying to compare, you need a baseline. So your affordable payment is your baseline. In the back, how clear is this stuff in the back? Can you see it at all? You still all right? Okay. I need to resize these slides if they don't work in the room. All right, I'm going to explain the categories once. N means term, means how many months. So in this case, 360 months. IYR is the interest rate. PV, present value, is the value of the, and if we're using loans, it'd be the value of loans. So if the loan amount was $100,000, that'd be present value. Payment, most people know payment is the amount you're either receiving or paying. And then future value, how much is the note worth at the end? We're talking about a fully amortized note, meaning at the end of its entire term, it's gone, it's zero. So in this case, it's always zero. I'm not gonna repeat 360 and zero every single time, it'll just you'll just hear me repeating it for no reason if you understand that. So to figure out the affordable payment, national average interest rate, we need to take the median affordable payment, which is the mortgage standards, or I don't know what the right term is, industry norms. The industry norm in the mortgage industry is you take your annual income divided by 12, and you take one-third of that, right? So one-third of your monthly income is the acceptable mortgage payment. It's like the staple. It varies. Most people say the normal person can afford their mortgage to be one-third of their monthly income, gross income. And that gives us, we put in a financial calculator, that gives us our maximum affordable median price, right? So we have our maximum affordable median payment by taking one-third of our gross income per month, and then we have our maximum affordable median price by putting in the financial calculator and determine just as high as the price can go in that area based on today's rates. What do you got, Charlie?
Are we going to rent some numbers?
No, this is all theory.
Oh, okay.
But Todd did tell me lunch today I need examples for that exact reason. We're trying to figure out how to make this better, more understandable. 100% I agree. Yeah, and I don't want to, if I get too much in the financial calculator, we'll be here 3 hours, so I have to be careful that we don't get into the weeds too deep. If I use round numbers, people may get through it quicker, though. Mm-hmm, I agree. Maximum rental purchase price. All right, so we're trying to determine if the property, you know, if you're buying a property to rent it out, what's the maximum you could pay in that market for that size home? So we take our national average interest rate again. We take 75% of the median rent. We put that in the payment column. Ooh, I found a typo. And we take that gives us the maximum rental purchase price. So now we just know the most we could pay for a rental in that area based on that average. Rebuild cost payment. So this goes into the theory that if you can buy a home for less than the rebuild cost, right, you buy the home, regardless of what the other fundamentals say in finance, because at some point somebody's going to build another one, and your home will be worth at least that. So national average interest rate again, we take the median home size sold, we take that rebuild cost, or sorry, to determine the median size home, I screw this one up every time. To determine the median size home sold rebuild cost, that's hard to say. We take the median home size sold and multiply that by the building cost per square foot, right? So a 1,000 square foot home, you know, times $100 a square foot to rebuild. And that gives us our payment, what the payment would be, not the dirt, just rebuilding the structure. So if it burnt down and you got the dirt for free. It happens sometimes. Go to Detroit right now. I guarantee you get some free dirt. Just got to pay the demo cost. I drove by a bunch of them over the weekend. We were out there. So then we need to determine the current third-year fixed median payment. So where we are in the market today. What is today's current third-year fixed payment? What are people paying? So we take our national average interest rate again, and then we take today's median sales price. And that gives us our 30-year fixed payment. What, based on the interest rate of today and the median sales price, what are people paying today? What's the median payment people paying today in your area? If you were around for the last cycle, you remember that we got into weird interest-only stuff, right? Like, those products exist, and the last buyers are the stupid investors, right? They're the ones that aren't investors, they're speculators, and they're using an interest-only product to buy your product. So the five-year interest-only median payment is how far can we go? How far can we push this market, right? Like, if everybody who's a traditional buyer stopped buying, and the only people that ever bought were people that were speculating, how far could they push this thing before there's nobody left? And all we gotta do to determine that is take the median sales price and multiply that by the median interest rate and divide by 12, because it's interest-only, there's no financial calculator required. And then we need to find the five-year interest-only max median or affordable payment and multiply that by 12. That one may be a little confusing. So what could people pay? And today, what can they actually afford? and then multiply that by 12, actually get the whole year, and then divide that by the national average interest rate, and that gives us the affordable payment. Yeah, I got it backwards, don't I?
Yeah.
It's backwards. Another typo. Switch these two.
So it's times 12.
So it's affordable payment times 12 times interest rate. It's times and times. Yeah. Yeah. I can do it real quick on here. That's why I got Todd. I come up with the weird creative shit. I give it to him in Excel and he fixes it. Todd didn't get this yet. All right, so now that we have all the data, we need to determine which market we're in. So these are usually in this order, right? Usually rebuild cost, replacement cost, is like the lowest a price goes, right? It usually shoots past median rent and goes into like the, you know, if you can buy a home for less than cost to build, you're getting a deal. You know, the next deal is if you can get a home at 75% or less of median rent, you're still getting a pretty damn good deal. Next is current 30-year fixed payment. Right now, it's like the average buyer. And then we get to the 5-year interest-only payment. You know, so the market tends to work its way through these down. What is the median affordable payment today? And we figure out where in this chart we are. Where in this line. All right. Here's a chart that's going to confuse the hell out of everybody. This will be good. All right. Every single thing you need to know is on this one sheet. And as Todd and I were talking about at lunch, the vertical lines, you don't actually need. I like them because the vertical lines are the prices, and the horizontal lines are the payments. All right, so the bar is price, this line is payment. I'm going to walk across this chart, and this one I'm going to spend some time on this because this is where all the weird, where all the patterns show up. So, Moreno Valley, I use Moreno Valley because Moreno Valley is like the canary in the coal mine. The LA civilization before the meth lab of Hemet. Back here, this is 2000. So, also, we just have very little data, with the exception of national data, outside of the MLS for prior to 2001, really. So, this first market, right, you can see like the prices hadn't really swung up. You could buy a property and rent it. Right here is 75% of median rent. This green line that shoots to the roof, this is the current payment. So people started paying a lot of money for their house. So right here in 2003, you could no longer buy a home and rent it for cash flow, which meant you had to leave the buy and hold, you know, territory because you couldn't rent it for cash flow. It would be negative cash flow. Between 2003 and 2005, you don't know what happens. And then a couple months later, you receive the data and know to change your strategy. The arrows all point backwards because the event happens and then you see the data. And then this gap right here, between 2005 and 2008, sell or pray, right? Well, you're speculating. I'm like, what do you mean I'm speculating? Everybody's speculating. But I was new and stupid, so I didn't know what they were talking about. Looking at this data, it's really obvious now, right? You can see that rents did go up, but they never kept pace with affordability. You look at your checkbook, and there's money left at the end of the month. This is what real people are actually paying, right? After your car payments and insurance and gas. People kind of forget that, like, they look at data like it's divorced from the day-to-day person. They lump everybody together, right? If your friend you see at the grocery store can't afford to move into your neighborhood, and they have the same job as you, start wondering what your market's doing. In the market within like 12 months of the market crashing. So in March of 2007, New Century went under, and all the end of 2007 into early 2008, you could actually buy in cash flow, and they actually cash flowed. I think we bought, it went from that one, the first one was Sweeney, was like 365, and you bought it at 142. Curve probably looks a little less big, right? But yeah, but the Inland Empire, that's why I use Moreno Valley, because it's so exaggerated. It's obviously the trend. Moreno Valley was worse, or the Inland Empire as a whole, was actually worse than Detroit. The market moved farther than Detroit. It was 60-something percent. It was a huge number. Again, we got this lagging indicator, right? That is probably not going to happen again for another 50 years. Really amazing systems. He doesn't based it on theory, just back test everything for 200 years. I have so many jokes. I have so many jokes for that. Training, so we do a 50-50. Members of our club would come in and bring us a deal. Money, we'd give them homework, and then we'd flip the deal. And last year, we started talking about the market change. Lance's meeting, right? We looked it up in like January. So Coal Banker Town and Country does a really big event out in the United States. They invite hundreds and hundreds of people out, all the greatest economists from the area. Todd and I sat through this conference at Cal Poly Pomona, and if those of you know anything about Cal Poly Pomona's Real Estate Research Council, there's some really smart people in that room, also USC, UCLA, like they all come together. Well, I saw a chart, and I still was holding property, and everybody went like this, and it was just a nice, soft curve, except for UCLA, it was pointed downward. And I was like, what's with this hockey stick? Oh, that guy's wrong, that can't be right. And everybody in the room said, no, everything's fine, it'll be a nice. So right here is 2020, and that's when the green line crossed the red line again. What people are paying.
Middle 2019.
The green line has left the building, right? It has gone over. This is in Moreno Valley, which means you guys are out here. You guys are 18 months to a year ahead of us, which means if you start buying today, you have less lead time. Now, based on some assumptions, I don't like to prognosticate because the broken clock's right twice a day, right? And if you're a Freakonomics fan at all, every single study they've done has shown that economic downturn, all you know is fundamental math. I know that the average person can't afford to buy the average home. Doesn't mean I know the market's gonna turn, it just means I'm not gonna buy anymore. This may go on for 5 years, it may go on for one, it may go on for 10. But I know that at any point somebody could pull the rug out from under me. 2021, this line right here, this is 2021 right here, this is 2019. So I have real data to the end of 2018. So the end of 2018 is right here. Today's payment is 103% of affordable payment. I mean, just squeaked over it. Yes. So that's what we're going to write. That's why our programmers told us to take like 2 weeks to do it. At the state level, we have the data for Southern California. We pay for the RETS feed from them for our fine sellers application. I think we need to spend another $30,000 a year to get nationwide data. I mean, it's not a lot. And then we need to also pay for the Marshall and Swift data, which I think is only another $10,000 a year. So it's not very expensive. But we're raising money for that company right now. Well, our CEO of that company is the one we invested in. And then when he's done raising that money, we're going to say, hey, here's this new product to put together. But he's putting together the deck right now, and we're going to send him out to go talk to people because we're the key investors. We only own 15% of the company. This is going to be an offshoot, but we're going to say, all right, we have this data feed. We can test it in this data feed, and then we can raise money for this new product separately. We can offshoot it. But yeah, it's not very difficult to program. So yeah, I do it by hand. Yeah. No, but you're right. It's not a difficult script to write at all. Detroit, Columbus, yes. Yeah, like a lot of Ohio, Michigan, yeah. Tennessee. You hear like people talking about Jersey because Jersey had, and Florida also. Become an REO broker, bank-owned properties. You'll start getting BPO work, I suspect, pretty soon. And if you have 100, 200, 300, 1,000 listings, like the brokerage I used to work for, we had 1,000 listings at any one point, you can do really well. You can make 7 figures a year really easily. And learn creative buying strategies. To focus on terms and not price, you can continue to buy through any cycle, risk-free, or very low risk, I should say. So I was listening, so bring up Freakonomics again. I was listening to Freakonomics, and they had three economists on, and they were going over Trump's new tax plan, and one of them was Trump's actual economist that he hired. Any blip, like a year ago, where he mentioned that the opportunities, and I'm like, whoa, 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 what was that? And I rewound it and listened to it over and over again. I was like, Todd, you got to see this. This is the craziest thing I've ever seen. So if you don't know what an opportunity zone is, and you find somebody, we're going to do one, but we won't probably do it for another year at least. You find somebody has an opportunity zone fund, meaning you could put your money, you could 1031 your money, only invest in these areas that the United States government, meaning state and national, has decided. Explain it all, because it's based on capital gains and based on, there's a bunch that goes into it. But essentially, if you want to keep your money, and you don't want to pay, and you don't have to worry about paying taxes on it, you don't need it today, find one of these funds. And we're probably going to form one because...
They're basically trying to incentivize one of these low-income areas where there's still commerce as like an option in that area. Like what we see that, you know, there's these businesses here, so you could make money in this area. It's got a potential there. But it is a low-income area, and they want to incentivize people like us to go in there
exactly.
And renovate and fix up and all that good stuff.
No, absolutely. And like we were looking at the maps, because by the way, if you search Opportunity Zones, California is a very clear color-coded map. It's very easy to find. Most of them are by us. So we're like, oh, sweet, they're all in our backyard. So it made it really easy. We knew all the territories. A tiny home company, and that stabilized. We have a production team in place. Before we grow to the larger warehouse, we're trying to do 1,000 units a year. The Opportunity Zone Fund?
Yeah.
The Opportunity Zone Fund, the tax deferment is so beneficial that you just buy the, we're going to focus on commercial, not residential.
Okay.
We're just going to buy the commercial property because that's really what they want you to do is build the infrastructure and just hold it for 10 years plus.
Okay.
And so like for San Bernardino, for example, I can go get a building in San Bernardino for $80,000 that will cash flow from the day we buy it if we put the money into it. It may be difficult to manage, right? And I know there's a lot of fallout. Matter of fact, we have the same investor friend in common that we talk about the stuff and... you know, Steve's first comment was like, well, those things are pretty heavy management. Well, they are, but that's why they give you the tax incentive because there's some fallout associated with it. I usually set blocks of time, 20 minutes an hour, whatever time you need, and we try and set an agenda so we can cover everything you need. You'll also get an automatic reply with a link to a class I'm teaching on creative buying strategies going into the next cycle. Everybody, it's all over. So I put together a cheap class on a weekend. was very creatively. That's my the core of my business.
When's your next class?
March 16th? I think March 16th. March 16th, I think. Whatever that Saturday is. And then if you have any questions or you want to set an appointment, let me know. What you got? I either take the rent, give you the long formula, but I usually take whatever the market rent is, multiply that by 65% to get 65% of market rent, multiply it by 12, and then I divide that by my cap rate, so let's just call it 10%. So I take that number and divide it by 0.10, and that's the price I'll pay. If it's not that price or lower, I won't buy it. So So we'll usually settle for 8. I'll take an 8 cap. When I'm talking to on a seller carry, Ward Hannigan, if you guys know him, Ward gave me one of the best strategies for talking to homeowner.
That are first time home buyers that want to go in and buy a home.
Yeah.
But they can't qualify for a 1% down or a 3% down loan because they make too much money. So in Pasadena, like if you go up that from like Washington up, there's no income limit requirement.
Do you know what it's based on? Sure.
They're trying to promote it when you said that opportunity. I think they're just trying to promote growth. And it's like, I think it's a process of like gentrification where like certain areas that used to be lower income.
Okay.
Now they're bringing in people that have a higher income limit and they're mixing it up and it's bringing the property value.
So it's like a government incentive to buy. You could pin the property and then flag says this is a Freddie Mac, you know, no limit zone.
God,
that'd be a great, yeah, that'd be a good flag.
Yeah.